This program contains views and opinions that may not be suitable for all audiences. Audience discretion is advised.
Welcome to Constructive Deconstruction, everybody. I am your host, Gomer the Ranting Thespian. My co-hosts, as always, are Holly Christine and Misha Mayhem.
Hello.
Hi.
And this is probably the peppiest we're going to be for the majority of the show, I think. Unfortunately. Because between the last show and this show, we in the internet reviewing online community that consists of sites like That Guy with the Glasses, my site, RT Gomer Productions, Nerdvice, and all of those other sites, we all lost somebody that a lot of us looked up to, a lot of us admired, and his name was Justin Carmichael, also known as JewWario. And what had happened is, no really way to sugarcoat it, you know, he killed himself. He just I can't even bring myself to say the rest of the specifics, because at this point we're recording this on the 31st. It is a week and a day after it actually happened. Everybody else found out last weekend.
Saturday.
So by the time you hear this, then it will have been a week since the news dropped. And everything got thrown up into the air. I mean, it's just everybody's mourning in their own ways. I mean, I eventually lost it, because I was never really close to Justin. I talked to him a few times, seen him at MAGFest a couple of times. In fact, he was in one of my MAGFest vlog videos from 2012. And just this past year, as I said in a video that I put out earlier this week, you know, he was at this MAGFest. He helped do the pub quiz, which was a lot of fun. And he also did the drawing for the Mega Man pixel art that I won at this year's MAGFest. And it was really nice. Really, he's just generally a great guy, you know, fun to be around. I mean, people out there are saying, yeah, he's a good guy, you know, he's nice, he's kind and everything, and it's pretty much true, you know. I mean, I've not had a bad experience with him. You know, some people, you know, he is not everybody's cup of tea, and that's understandable.
The really interesting thing about it is that people who didn't watch his videos and thus weren't really a fan with him still had really kind things to say about him.
That's
that
true.
That he was so nice, that he was so friendly, that, you know, they met him, and somebody was telling me that they met him and it was weird because they were so excited to meet him and he seemed more excited to be meeting them.
He loved his fans.
Like,
he did.
They were a big deal.
Oh yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah, and that's something I kind of want to, you know, emulate myself in that sense, you know, like, because I know I have fans out there, fans that would love to meet me, and if I haven't before, I want to have that same attitude that Justin did, you know. Fan comes up, oh my god, it's JewWario, and then just go back, oh my god, it's you, you're a fan, yay, that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. That is something I want to emulate from here on out, and I'm saying this on the show so people can hold me to it.
I would say the same, but I don't have fans, so
I'm sure you do.
Usually, what happens with me is people will come up to me, and I mean, it's sort of the same experience that I had with you, Misha, where it was like you were surprised that I knew who you were. Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. And fans will come up to me and they'll be like, oh my gosh. And I'm like, oh, hey, it's you. Like, I know who you are.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had a similar situation with Butching Up Roses in 2012. So it was like, yeah. So
oh,
I had
like
a real feeling.
Her.
Yeah. But yeah, she was one of the ones that she ended up taking it among the hardest. And of course, there were a few other people that were taking it really hard. And as we're recording this, they're actually doing a memorial stream, you know, to just sit and talk about Justin. And this show's kind of way of doing that too. But there are some other things we do have to address surrounding everything. But we'll get to that. We'll get to that.
I just want to mention that maybe I mean, I don't know Roses very well, but I'm sure she's struggling a bit with it too, because she struggled with depression and this stuff as well.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of, it kind of makes you think when you have dealt with it, because I myself have thought about it a lot too, because I have been diagnosed with depression and, you know, have struggled with self-harm and stuff.
Yeah, and full disclosure on my part as well, I've had similar thoughts. I've been in similar places mentally, and I would always, it does. Thankfully, I've always been able to get myself out of it for one reason or another. And if I had been in that kind of a position now, like when the news dropped or whatever, the outpouring of everybody would have snapped me out of it for sure. Because not just because of the love and the outpouring, and that's there, and that's a good thing. I also realized that, you know, at least on my own level, the thing that would keep me from doing it is the fact that I would hurt a lot of people if I did it. And that, I mean, it's obviously not enough for everybody, which, tragically.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, that works enough, you know.
In the full name of disclosure, I've attempted twice, and obviously I'm still here for a reason, so...
Yeah.
I'm glad that it didn't take.
I am too.
I mean, I have really shitty days sometimes, especially with my depression, but there are people and things that make it worth being alive.
Yeah, very much so. And, you know, but unfortunately, as I said, tragically, it doesn't always work, and unfortunately, it wins. And my best friend, when I told her the news, first of all, when she asked why, it killed me. It's like, I'm a pretty stoic person. You know, mm-hmm. I could take the worst news ever, you know. I mean, I probably, there would be few deaths that would make me just break down and cry outside of the death of my parents, you know, when that day comes, and I'm not looking forward to it. But,
right.
But just, you know, I mean, even if somebody that I was closer to were to die, depending on the closeness, I would probably still be able to hold it in. Even if it's just by myself, I would hold it in.
My nanny Farah died, like, right before last, not this past MAGFest, but before, and I wasn't very close to her, and I'm not gonna lie, I think I cried more about Justin's death than I did my own great-grandmother's.
Yeah, which...
Because I spent more time around Justin, even if it was just at MAGFest and stuff, and I know that sounds terrible, but it's true.
Yeah, well, that's the thing, you had more experience with him than... You know, your grandparents. I mean, it's kind of the same way with me. You know, I've, you know, three of my grandparents have died since I was born.
Right.
You know, I wasn't unremorseful. I mean, I still mourned, but I didn't totally break down and lose it.
But, my family's not close either at all. The people that I would probably cry the most about, my mom, my dad, my brother, and my uncle. I'm not close with any of the rest of my family. And also, I've never had anybody close to me die. This is like Justin dying is the closest I've ever been to anybody that's died.
Right. And...
See, that's one of those things that's really hard for me to imagine. You know, because I was probably 6 years old when my great-grandmother, who I called Nana, died. And that just completely rocked my world. And, you know, then since then, it's just been family death after family death. And while I'm not super close with, like, all of my aunts and uncles and cousins and stuff, I was very close to my grandparents.
Yeah.
So, yeah, see, I don't have that with any of my
family.
And my
grandmother especially.
Right.
And so, and you're not the only one. There's actually a pretty prominent reviewer who mentioned that he's never had to deal with a close death before either. And so...
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think the only person that I really talk to on a regular basis outside of my parents and my brother is my uncle, and... So, honestly, I wouldn't even, like, this is how unclose my family is. I don't even know if I would know if my granddad died.
Yeah.
Because he has a new family and everything, because my grandma and he got a divorce after 52 years of marriage, and basically he dropped the entire family except for my aunt, and for his new family. So I don't even know if I would know if he died.
Damn. But, yeah. But yeah, I brought up my, you know, my stoicism to say that all it took in this situation was my best friend asking why. Now, she herself was never really close to Justin. She met him at most at MAGFest 2012 because, you know, we were both mm-hmm. there. And she didn't watch his videos. She barely knew the guy except what, you know, what was going on. And, of course, she and I talk about a lot of the things. And knowing what had happened and how it happened, you know, she broke down. And that destroyed me as well. And she railed against depression, which I don't think it's been officially stated what it was that caused it, but I think a lot of people are thinking it is depression that got him to that point. I'm thinking.
I've just been saying to people to not speculate because
right. Thank
there
you.
Are so many
Thank
things
you.
That could have been going through
oh
his
God.
Head at the moment.
Yes.
And knowing what happened and, you know.
Okay.
Yes. I've been saying the same thing.
Which
I think it's really horrible to speculate about it. Like, I
actually got really upset and posted on Kotaku mm-hmm. because everybody was like, oh, depression this,
yeah.
depression that. And I was like, you know, as somebody who was, you know, Justin's friend, Justin's former manager, you know.
Yeah, it's not nice to speculate about. Like, you don't know. Like, and I
yeah.
think, and a lot of fans are speculating about it. It's like, I think that here's my opinion on the matter. I think the only people that should be allowed to speculate, and this is just my opinion, mm-hmm. his family and his close friends, not people that just met him once or twice or think they knew him really well or something.
Right.
Just by being your fan. I think it's the right of his friends and his close friends and his family to speculate, but everybody else kind of needs to shut the hell up about it because it's just going to cause problems. It really, really is. It's super tricky.
Right. And it's understandable. And I do apologize. I don't.
No, no.
I'm not trying
You're not
to,
the worst. Trust me.
Yeah. I'm not trying to
yeah.
sit there and be like, oh my God, is this why, you know, but. You know.
Yeah, well, because, you know, we didn't talk about exactly what happened, and it's, you know, he had locked himself in the bathroom, and he was talking to his wife through the bathroom door, and she stated that he knew that everybody loved him, mm-hmm. But he did end up shooting himself.
Yeah.
Right. So, it's like, yeah. knowing Justin... And knowing that, you know, his wife has said that he knew that everybody loved him, you know, I'm inclined to think that it, you know, it's probably not depression and it's probably Justin doing what he thought was in the best interest of people.
Okay.
And, you know, whatever that may be, I don't know. Like, maybe it was because... You know, everybody knew that Justin was going through money issues. Because
I didn't know that actually until that the news came out that he had killed himself.
Oh,
I did
okay.
not know that.
Well, yeah, because he's been, you know, he did the Indiegogo for the
Famicom
Runner.
Yeah.
yeah. Mm-hmm. And then he started the Patreon page, you know, making it very clear that. You know, he wanted to be able to do this as his job, but in order to do that, he needed some help.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I don't know if that played a part of it, but it's like, you know, to just blame it on depression. And what pisses me off about that is people are like, oh, well, you know, there's nothing wrong with having depression. I'm like, I'm not saying that there's anything wrong, but if you're going to pin a mental disorder on somebody mm-hmm. in the wake of their death,
yep. And not
when
only
you
is
have
it
no way
to
prove it. I mean, you're implying that he killed himself because he was depressed. Thus, you are implying
right.
that depression is a bad thing.
Yes.
And I'm trying
it,
to say
it, yes.
that
yes.
it could have been anything. You know?
Right. And not
everybody
only
saw him at MAGFest. He was very happy. He was, you know, nobody had any clue that this was coming.
It's called putting on a face. A lot of people do it. And honestly, not only is blaming depression for it disrespectful to Justin's memory and also to his fans and friends and family members, but it also gives even more of a stigma to depression. And it makes, you know, it makes people who have depression look like, you know, basket cases who could blow at any second and end up, you know, just shooting themselves for no reason. And that's bullshit.
Yeah.
It's absolute bullshit.
Yeah. And with all of that.
And I also.
And with all of that said, actually, there was also an outpouring at the same time of the mourning and everything, and not even addressing any one, like, potential issue or potential thing or whatever is, if you get into that kind of a headspace where you want to, you know, kill yourself or what have you, you know, talk to somebody. And I know
Justin was talking to his wife. That was really my thing.
Yeah.
Like, if you ever get into the headspace where you think that committing suicide is the right thing to do, whether you're sad about it or you're calm about it or whatever, if you get to a place where you think that that's okay, you need to talk to somebody.
Yes.
If you think you're going to get to a place where you're going to think that that's okay, you need to talk to somebody.
Yes, that
right.
That is the biggest point to come out of this, especially out of this part of the conversation here. And right. Again, when I brought up the depression thing earlier, I wasn't intentionally trying to sit there and speculate. It's just, you know.
We know. You don't have to explain
it. It's okay. In my explaining why I think that it's probably not depression, I did a little bit of speculating on my own, and it's hard not to when something like this happens.
We all have.
Okay.
We don't know what happened, and we will never know why it happened.
Right.
Well, I mean, maybe, you know, eventually there will be some clue as to why, but if not, it's honestly, we're not owed an explanation.
No, we're not.
Not really.
No.
And also on the flip side, I want to say this too. There are a couple other things that bothered me. People calling suicide selfish. I can't even with that. Like,
I mean, there are a lot of people, you know, and that pisses me off too. Especially when when you're dealing with elderly suicides and it comes to end of life issues. You know, my grandmother ended up refusing medical treatment at the end of her life. She had been battling multiple myeloma, which is a cancer of the bone marrow, for 18 years.
Yikes.
She was the only person in her test group to live that long.
Whoa.
When she was diagnosed in 1983 or 1984, she was given 6 months to live.
Wow.
So, you know, and she made a choice. She made a conscious decision that she wasn't going to fight anymore, and she was just going to let it take her. And, you know, it was her right to do so.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, and with all of this said as well, you know, you brought up it was her right to do so. I would also argue that, yeah, it is your life. It is your right to take it. And as we also said, if you get to that headspace, talk to somebody, because you never know. I mean, maybe that person can't talk you out of it, or maybe you just need to talk to somebody and put your mind at ease or something. We don't know why, but
the difference between committing suicide and, you know, choosing to not proceed with more, you know, medical,
it's different
procedures to save your life. It's different because she wasn't actively taking her own life.
Right.
But it's still not, I think that both of them, and in my personal opinion, neither of them are selfish.
Yeah.
No, I don't think they are. I mean, because the reason I brought that up in the first place is, you know, say she did just decide that she knew that what she was about to do was going to be really painful, not just for her, but for everyone around her. Mm-hmm. You know, if she had, you know, chosen to end her own life, it would have hurt, yes. Would it have hurt more than losing her in general? I don't think so.
No.
Right.
And
at least she probably prepared you guys for it a little bit, as much as she could, right? Like,
Oh, yeah.
Most people who commit suicide, they don't do that because the people around them would try to stop them.
Yeah, and I think that's where we're... I'm going to guess on this one. I'm going to guess that's where some people may get the selfish vibe from with people who commit suicide, because it's no notice, no warning. You just kill yourself. You don't let us know and let us all pick up the pieces.
Well, you know, right.
I can see where that mindset comes from.
But say, just as an example, mm-hmm. we knew somebody who had a terminal illness who then chose to take their own life. You know, we're putting our own selfishness above any of their wants and desires by wanting them to suffer until they die.
Right.
Yeah, it's like, where do you draw the line, honestly? Yeah.
Instead of letting them have a choice.
And here's my thing with people who commit suicide out of depression and out of, you know, being hurt. You know what's even more selfish? The people who are saying that it was selfish for them to commit suicide, that were treating them like crap to begin with and made them feel like they had to commit suicide.
Yeah.
Yeah. Actually, that brings up a point, and I won't mention this person's name, but I had a fan come to me 2 days ago, and he felt very bad because he had gotten into an argument with Justin.
Oh.
I don't know what the argument was about, and the guy just felt really bad, and he wanted to... make it up to Justin, and he wanted to, I think he said, atone for this crusade that he had sort of gone on with Justin. I mean, this is the same guy who got into a fight with me about Noah.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
You know, and he comes to me very calmly and rationally, and it's why I chose to speak to him about it. And you know, he's like, I don't know what to do because I feel so bad. And I've seen all of this outpouring of love. And, you know, he saw the clip of Justin that was taken from one of his streams, the "You Are Not Stupid."
Mm-hmm. Which we've all played on everything that we've done. Yeah.
Yeah. And we'll probably have it at the end of this, too. Cause
I also played the Mr. Rogers End theme at the end of my podcast too, because of Justin.
Yeah.
But yeah, and he was like, I don't know what to do. I don't know how to make it up to him. And you know, this, he felt bad because and I understand that he didn't want to feel like he played a part in it. And all I could tell him was, you know, first of all, I can only think of one person in the world that Justin probably has a grudge against, and it's not you.
Yeah.
So don't worry about that. And two, Justin wouldn't want you to feel guilty. Yeah. You know, the fact that you're learning from this experience and you're learning how to approach people and you're learning, you know, how to behave in a more caring and loving manner instead of just being harsh and critical and, you know, condescending. When you don't have all the facts, you know, mm-hmm. Justin would want you to learn from that. And he would want you to, you know, try to emulate the behavior that you now see that Justin lived, you know.
Right.
That he was a very caring guy, that he did genuinely, like, you know, I think it was Rollo T who said that, you know, you always hear people say, oh, he was the nicest guy and all of that. And with Justin, it was really true. You know, you always hear about people saying, oh, you know, he cared so much about whatever. But no, Justin actually cared. Like, he would ask fans about the things that were going on in their lives that they just assumed that he didn't know or wasn't keeping track of or whatever.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, this is kind of a random memory thing. But back a few years ago, I think it was 2010. You know, when everything was still going, I think it was after Kickassia had been released and come out or whatever. He and Kaylin, Mars Girl, were on Twitter, and they were talking about how they don't have Facebook pages or whatever, you know, for fans to come to or whatever. But they felt really uncomfortable in just creating one for themselves, because they didn't feel like they should do that. So I stepped up, said, you know what, challenge accepted, creating one for both of them. And both of them got pretty good mileage out of it. I think I think at last check, Justin's page was somewhere between 1 and 2,000 likes. I'm going by memory here. If, please, somebody correct me if I'm wrong on that one. If I don't put a note in the notes here, but by the time this goes up. And that's just one of those random memories that I have of Justin. Like, just, you know, hey, you know, here you go, dude. You know, fan page for you.
4,374.
Wow. Going back to what Holly was saying, I honestly, a lot of people know that I had it out with Justin once, and I, even though that was forever ago, not really forever ago, but a while ago, I still feel bad about that. But, I mean, again, it's not about me. And I, and like Gomer, I keep going back to my memories, of the good memories of Justin that I had. I was talking the other day on Snarkast about the first time I ever met him. It was at MagFest 10, and I was a con noob. I had never been to, like, a big con or whatever before. And MagFest, to me, is bigger than any con that I've been to. I've never been to, like, MegaCon or anything, but... I was sitting, like I did a lot that weekend, sitting at the tables by myself because I had no idea what to do. Mm-hmm. And Justin was coming through looking for somebody on Thursday night, and I shyly said hi to him. He came over and gave me a hug that felt like it was crushing every bone in my body. But but not as much as it does when Welshie hugs you.
Welshie, oh my God.
Welshie knocks the air out of you and makes you feel like you're going to like lose consciousness. But...
I'm pretty sure I wet myself the first time he hugged me because he like lifted me up off the ground.
Yes. but that was my first memory of Justin. And then actually even before that, I was actually I used to go to a stream sometimes, and a few weeks before that, I had decorated my apartment door like I do every year for Christmas because I don't have a tree because I have a small apartment and, you know, five cats. I decorated my door because I was a Tick with Tick fan at the time in a holiday clusterfuck theme. And I put one of my pieces was Justin in a Santa hat and gave him his little stocking or whatever. And I linked it in the stream and he thought it was the cutest thing ever and told me he was honored to be on the door.
Aww.
Let's see what else. And then there's like, I did, like I said, I did have it out with him once. And then a few weeks later at MagFest 11, we hugged it out. And that was at the quiz thing, which was cool.
Yeah.
And then turned really awkward that night because Katie. But
which
the dance off, for those of you who don't know what she's referring
to
there.
Yeah, exactly. But I do remember those are the memories that I like to keep alive of Justin because, I mean, like I said, I wasn't a fan of his really. And I did take issue with him on some things, but I do have a lot of fun memories of him. And I'm grieving in my own way. I cried a lot. And I just want to keep the good memories of Justin alive because that's what Justin would want.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Oh, God.
I cried a lot, too. And, you know, speaking of that dance-off and the good memories of Justin, if you guys haven't seen it, watch the Game Chasers tribute video to Justin.
Yeah,
because they cut in, you know, footage of Justin that they filmed at this past MagFest. And then they were also talking about the dance contest, which they were pretty sure that he chose a dance off because was it Jay who did the dancing? I can't remember. Anyway, one of the guys does a really good robot dance. And they were pretty sure that that's why Justin picked a dance off.
That's adorable.
You know, and then they noted that, like, you know, then Katie dances and the crowd's going crazy. So then that's when he ripped off his shirt and started writing it.
Oh dear. And
that thing.
And
that
thus
thing that
all
happened.
The panties in the room were immediately soaked.
Oh my God.
I saw one of the, I think it was Jillian, had took some behind-the-scenes photos of Tboldly Flea, not photos, but video,
yeah.
Tboldly Flea of Justin doing his thing and Lewis just breaking.
Yeah, you guys can find that either on Jillian's Facebook or on my fan page,
yeah.
My Facebook fan page. I posted that video because You can hear us both. We're both taking different behind the scenes footage. And unfortunately, we don't know what happened to my behind the scenes footage. It seems to have been lost.
Oh, no.
Yeah. But so thankfully, Jillian was also shooting that with her phone.
Yes.
And, you know, it was funny because there wasn't a whole lot of people down there in the set, but it was like, and Justin was kind of nervous about it, but he just, you see him just totally go for it. And then Lewis can't hold it together because Justin's like jumping up in his face and like poking him. And
yes.
Oh, God.
I would have a hard time too. And this is the guy who is able to do the worst.
And it was cute too, because he comes up to me before we shoot the scene and he's so nervous about having to take off his top, and you know, because it was like, you know, him in the tight pants, like he had worn them before and he wasn't that self conscious about it, but he was really self conscious about taking off his top.
Yeah. Which I can kind of relate to that, honestly. Because, you know, I'm not exactly Mr. Six-Pack Abs here myself, but I think I could understand his headspace on that one, because I would have been the same way. But
man,
once you get in there,
the better.
Once you get in there, you just go balls to the wall for it, and
right.
That looks like that's what he did, and you know, mad props for that. Oh, man. Oh, so, yeah, there was something else I thought about saying, but it kind of got lost somewhere. Oh, well.
Can I?
Just talking about To Boldly Flee just brings up another memory, but that Tao Te Ching book that Justin is seen reading throughout that. First of all, it's a fake cover on the actual George Takei book.
Nice.
So Rob makes this fake cover and then puts it on the book, but Justin actually read a lot of that book during the shoot.
Can you blame him? It's George Takei.
Yeah.
All right.
He was like, oh, this is so good. It's so interesting.
Yeah. And of course, even I have very limited experience when it comes to like being on the set for a movie, because I had like a small bit part. You know, I was like a background character in a film at one point. Yeah. I believe it's called Born and Raised. I'm literally a background character.
The fuck?
Yeah, it's a small independent. It's a small independent film that was filmed in Panama City, Florida, or technically Panama City Beach, Florida.
Interesting.
And it's one of those things. It's you get there and it's a lot of waiting. You have to wait for your part to come up. You have to wait for this and that, and then you do your thing, and then once you're done with that, you pretty much go home. After that. Which it was a lot of fun. Oh God, driving home from Panama City after that, because I live an hour away. Oh, that was fun, and I hadn't slept. It was an overnight thing. Yeah, but I can understand that. So him being able to read that book during the shooting of To Boldly Flee, I can believe it.
Yep. Yeah, because there's a lot of, you know, you have to be quiet in the attic.
Mm-hmm.
Because that was the green room.
Yeah.
Which was unfortunate because it was like an uncommonly warm April, and you're sticking 20 nerds in a room where they have to wear the same costume for like 7 days.
Oh.
In an attic room. And we couldn't turn on the air conditioning because of the noise. Plus, it was the set had already been partially built for that room, mm-hmm. and the air conditioner was behind part of the set.
Oh, Jeeves.
That's disgusting.
Oh, I no envy there. No envy for at least for that particular part.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah. So so with all of the outpouring of the love and the videos and the mourning, the last 26 or so minutes of the show, I hate to bring it up, but this is part of it, and we gotta cover everything. There was also a bunch of negativity from the internet as a whole.
Mm.
Needless to say, if you have not been to Encyclopedia Dramatica, don't. Please,
oh, God.
Fuck, don't.
I don't even want to think about it. I mean, even the legit news sites that have been posting it, I mean, some of this stuff just gets so negative.
Yeah, there's also there's actually a thread on FQA, Frequently Question Answers, which is a board I frequent along with Hagen and Ironbite. And they had the thread up there, and a lot of them were in there were, you know, the people on the board were nice. They were respectful. They were nice. And at one point at the beginning of the thread, they were like, okay, Encyclopedia Dramatica didn't, you know, they haven't touched them. So maybe they have a little bit more respect for it. Five posts later, think again. And so I went and read, and I had to, my soul cried a little bit there. And what's even worse is FARC. One of the news stories for Justin's death made it onto FARC.com, which is where I get most of my news stories for Thespian Talk and the stuff we bring up on this show as well. And while there were some respectful comments, there was a lot of just nasty and mean-spirited comments towards Justin on the FARC thread that I looked at. And to the credit of some people that did post, there were the respectful ones, and then there were the ones that were calling out the assholes. So, you know, so points where it's due, but I'm scared away from FARC comment sections for a while. I'll still go to the links that they post up there, but I'm staying away from the goddamn comments.
There are a few assholes in every bunch, and they won't stop even in times like this. Like, honestly, I can say this, even the people that the internet reviewing community has labeled as trolls, like on Twitter and stuff, even they've been respectful.
Yeah.
I have to admit. I have talked to one of them, and they've been asking a lot of questions, but they haven't been disrespectful because they're just trying to figure it out along with the rest of us.
Yeah.
Even though the speculation should just not be there, but again, I understand to some extent because everybody's just trying to figure out it on their own. But
trying to make sense of something, but to like, you know, you're trying to make sense of something that is never going to make sense. And you know, if you want to talk about that privately, that's fine. Right.
Yeah,
but I will say this: people have been really ill-timed in some of the stuff with it, like right after the news broke, and I'm not mentioning this person's name, but I legitimately almost unfriended them because I thought it was really fucking inappropriate. They knew that, you know, I wasn't fond of Justin for some reasons, and they came at me like legitimately came up accusing me of being wrong about this and wrong about that and blah blah blah, and I meant somebody else. And he was like, and I called him out for it, and he's like, well, it's the investigative journalist in me. It's like, this is a death, not national. This isn't you trying to get a news piece. I basically told him to fuck off because, honestly, that was legitimately fucked up.
Yeah, I mean, yes, I know there are going to be journalists out there that are going to cover a thing like this. He was not one of them. I know who you're talking about.
I was pissed. He's lucky that he's still on my friends list. Because that was, I was like, are you fucking kidding me? It was literally 5 minutes, not even 5 minutes after the news broke.
Yeah, I mean, and of course you are going to have your anti-JewWario fans out there that are ranging from, you know, okay, he's gone, we don't have to worry about him anymore, to fucking celebrating it.
Oh, that one person on Twitter.
Yeah, that person who got banned on Twitter, or like, there's... You know, you expect it from, like, Reddit or 4chan to just have these people be assholes. But, like, one of the reasons I ended up saying something on Kotaku was because somebody made some comment about, like, you know, the Wii U's release wasn't that disappointing. And it was like, seriously?
Oh.
A man killed himself. And you're going to make some stupid crack about Nintendo?
It's like, really?
Like, this was a human life.
It's like, jeebus, no.
I don't care if you know him or you don't.
There is a time. I am of the opinion there is a time for just about every kind of joke out there.
Right.
Whether you agree with suicide jokes or not, this is not the time for it.
Nope. It really isn't.
It's just, no. I mean, and here's the thing. If it had been a different situation, if the circumstances had been different, I may have found that a little funny. But with the situation as it is now, and the effect it's having on everybody that they know in his circle, and even people I had no idea knew who he was. In fact, I mean, one of the Let's Players I follow, He surprised me because he knew who Justin was. I had no idea he knew. I mean, I guess it shouldn't be so far-fetched considering they're both video game guys.
Oh, I'm finding out that more and more and more and more people knew Justin. I'm like, well, damn.
Yeah. It's like, you know, but the scope of the effect of this has had, it's like, no, do not make that joke. And this is coming from a guy who has a generally thin to no filter to begin with.
Yeah, and me too, because you know, you guys, like, people who've listened to this show before, they know, like, I make crude and horrible jokes all the time, mm-hmm. but even I have a filter at times like
this.
Yeah,
we've all had our share of inappropriate humor on this show.
Oh, yeah.
Right. And yeah, there's, you know, like I said, it's a, for God's sake, it's a human life. Like, have you no respect just for that?
Right.
Even if you don't know him, like, even if you don't know the circumstances, like, why would you choose that moment to make that joke?
That brings up the whole thing of, is it ever okay to be happy that someone is dead?
I think it really, really depends on the situation.
So do I. And I came up with a few examples the other night on Snarkast. International terrorists like Osama bin Laden, and Saddam Hussein. Also, for me, closer to home, when Jerry Falwell died in 2007, or then there's also the domestic terrorists like Westboro Baptist Church,
and I'm also thinking you brought up domestic terrorists. I also thought Tim McVeigh.
Yes, Charles Manson, mm-hmm. stuff like that. Here's my stance on that. I think it's okay to be happy that they're gone, but in a setting where it's their loved ones aren't going to see you being an ass about it.
Right.
Because, okay, even though I hated Jerry Falwell with a fiery passion, I would not stand up in front of his wife or his sons and be like, bah, ha, 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 your loved one's dead.
Right. Because that's just not cool. The only exception to that would be if the family starts it, at least for me. If the family starts it, that's a different story. But and even then, that's kind of a gray area.
To be completely honest. It is a gray area, and I feel bad saying that I think it's okay for it to be a thing sometimes, but let's face it, Jerry Falwell especially, like, he made the lives of a lot of people miserable.
Yeah.
He, you know, because of him, people, women in Lynchburg, Virginia can't go get, if they decide they want an abortion, can't go have a safe abortion because guess what? He got Planned Parenthood get kicked out of town. And, you know, the health department isn't a lot of help a lot of times. So they, basically women can't get their gynecological visits. They to you know, make sure that people would like, these women would like to be screened for stuff like HPV and stuff. So yeah, he kicked out, you know, he kicked Planned Parenthood out because apparently all they did was abortions, which is total bullshit. That's a different time for a different time. And also, he made the lives of a lot of gay people, LGBT people, really miserable. And honestly, I think that, and I'm, this is just me speculating a little bit, but I wouldn't doubt it if he and the rest of his cohorts made, you know, a lot of the lives of LGBT people in Lynchburg so horrible that they possibly could have, you know, just have to end their lives because, you know, people like him.
Yeah, and there have been cases, not because of him specifically, but because of, you know, just the oppression and the stuff against them.
And the conversion therapy. Again, there's a reason why Exodus International closed their doors and apologized to harming the lives of LGBT people.
Yeah. I mean, and there's a reason why South Park did an episode on it. You know, because it is an issue and needs to be addressed. But we'll address that larger issue on another show.
Oh, yeah,
show.
Definitely.
But the point that's trying to be made here
is people, you know, like him.
Yeah. If the negatives far, and I mean far, outweigh the positives, then okay. You know,
well, it depends on who you ask, because jury follow-up depends here 50-50, basically. Well, 75-25. But...
Yeah, and a lot of times it is, you know, it is on your own personal thing. And you know, as much as I'm not comfortable saying it, the same would apply to everybody, including Justin. And I know there are people out there, you know, trolls or not, that their experiences with him were more negative than positive, and you know, to the degree to where they're glad he's gone. Luckily, at least the ones I know, at least one or two people personally that are in that camp, they've been quiet about it because they actually have respect for the people who are mourning.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. You know, so I mean, you know, I personally don't agree with those people, obviously, but mm-hmm. you know, they are out.
Right. Well, I said something about, you know, this portion of the subject the other day, which is, you know, just because a person has done a shitty thing doesn't make them a bad person, you know.
But what if they do a lot of shitty things?
Well, if they do a lot of shitty things, then they're probably a shitty person. I, you know, it's hard for me to say that it's ever really okay to celebrate somebody's, you know, death. Particularly a violent death.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, I certainly understand, especially if, you know, you're a victim of, you know, a particular terrorist action, or, you know, people who celebrated the death of Hitler because they were in concentration camps. You know, I'm certainly not going to say I don't understand where they're coming from.
Right.
Right.
You know, because I've never been in an experience where somebody who I've, you know, had a very strong disliking for was killed or, you know, died or whatever. So, I can't say whether or not I would be okay with that. It, you know, it's sort of like along my feelings on the death penalty. Like, do I think it's okay? You know, in the spirit of things... No, not really. But if I were in an experience where somebody killed my family members, would I want that person to die?
Yeah.
I probably would. So it's really hard for me to say, you know, at what point does a personal sense of vengeance outweigh a moral good?
Right. Even, like I said, back in 2007 when Jerry Falwell did die, I was actually still one of those Christians and was actually... I was not sad, but indifferent, because this is like the semester before I went there for that one semester. However, looking back, one of my personal feelings are good, probably, you know, best that he's not around, because, I mean, even though his sons are terrible, they're not as terrible as he was.
Right.
But at the same time, I think that... Here's my thing. I think that I would give it a little bit of time before I said anything with my personal feelings about it if I was glad they were gone. And again, not in front of their family members.
No.
With people like Westboro Baptist Church, I don't think it would matter because they would spew hate at either end. But I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, it's one of those things. Very complicated, very sticky issue. And... Truth be told, even all of this said, if, you know, let's say Fred Phelps were to keel over dead, you know,
bye-bye.
Tomorrow.
Sorry.
You know? let's say he would, okay. And me personally, I would probably report on it, and I'd probably have the overall. Response of, okay, then maybe that thing can change now that he's gone, you know.
No.
I'm not going to go out and get like 20 bottles of Lambic and get drunk or anything over it.
You're not going to protest his funeral like they would protest yours, because that would make you sink to their goddamn level.
Right.
Right. I mean, that's part of it for me, is that, you know, if you're happy that somebody has died because they're such a hateful person, then the last thing that you want to do is turn around and be, you know, excited and celebrating their death, because, you know, then you're not really any better than they are.
Yeah.
But, you know, for me overall,
It's like, would I be relieved that Fred Phelps died? Yes. Fuck yes.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
But it's more a sense of relief than an excitement that he's dead.
Yeah.
Right.
Nobody's going to be rubbing off to this.
I think actually that's a lot. That was the response to Jerry Falwell. A lot of people were like, oh, good. He's gone. Now the gays can be gay and without, you know, gay bashing, which isn't even remotely true.
Yeah.
But,
hopefully we'll get there.
Yeah. They still have, as far as I know, they still have ex-gay conversion therapy at Liberty University if you go there as an out student or if you come out there. Although, and this pisses me off, there's a guy who said that he went to Liberty as an undergraduate, as an out gay man. He never got any flack, never got called anything bad while on campus, and never had to go to ex-gay conversion therapy. I'm like, you're full of fucking bullshit. Go away.
Either that or he's extremely lucky.
Or he's getting sucked off by Jerry Falwell Jr., but I digress.
Yeah, but to kind of take it back more into the positive and back to the beginning, because I do not want to end the show on a negative note.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry about
that. No, it's okay. We needed to cover everything, so, you know.
Yeah.
You know, the good and the bad, that's one of the things I try and do.
And the ugly, because that's Shirley Phelps, but details.
Oh.
Buzzing.
Buzzing. So, anyways, to kind of round out and finish up, Justin, as we said, he was, for whatever faults he had, on the whole, he was a great guy. Like we noted that Rollo T said, you hear a lot of people after they die, oh, he was a nice man, he was a great guy. And in this case, it's all true. Like I said, all of my experiences with Justin have been nothing but positive, nothing but, just good times and smiles and just general greatness. So, and in fact, I am proud to report that when he did, you're going to see it at the end of this show, but the You Are Not Stupid clip that is going around, I was actually in the audience when he said that. And even then, between then and even now, it still rings true. Because, because none of us are idiots, We're not stupid. We're going to go out there. We are going to do amazing things, And the reason why it's playing at the end is because I can't do it justice. I had thought about just, transcribing it and reading it in his honor, but the man put it a lot better himself.
Yeah, I read it out loud on the memorial stream that we did on Radio Dead Air on Saturday when everybody found out.
Yeah.
And somebody actually cut the clip that is now going around out of the larger stream.
Yes,
they did. Because they heard me read it out loud.
Yeah.
And I was very thankful for that because, one, I'm crying as I'm reading it because it's so touching and... it then thus makes Justin's death all the more tragic.
Yeah.
But they do deserve to hear it from Justin.
Yes.
Yep.
Because, no matter what, those are words that everybody should hear.
Oh, yes. Definitely.
Everybody. if we send up a satellite, if we want to do like they did, what was it, the Christmas Invasion, where they sent out a satellite to just, say hi to other planets or beings or whatever. They need to put that clip in there. They need to. Because that has to happen. Because that would be one of those things I would spread to the universe. Is, you're going to go out there, you're going to do great things. And the great things that you do, they may not be world-changing, they may not be... they may not be earth-shattering. You may not save the world with your great things.
Maybe not at that time, but maybe you could plant a seed to make greater change.
Yes, there is that. But but the great things you do may be great to just those who are around you, that are in your life now.
Which is also very important.
Yes. And who knows, if it's great enough that it'll spread on its own, whether you're alive or whether you're gone.
The things that you do to the people who are around you are the most important things that ever get done.
Yes.
Yep.
And,
you know, to sort of paraphrase Doctor Who, you know, an ordinary guy is the most important kind of guy in the universe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, the ordinary person, because, you know, those small things don't just affect the person you know, it affects everyone they know, and it infects everyone they know, and, you know.
Yeah. It's like throwing
it
a pebble.
It makes a difference.
Yeah. It's like throwing a pebble into a pond. You know, it makes it splash, and then you have the ripples that go out. And that's pretty
that
much
is a
like
definitely,
everything.
Yeah, that's definitely a good symbol for Justin's infectious personality.
Mm-hmm. And it's like it was next to impossible for even me. And then I've had my lower moments, my darker moments. You know, it was nearly impossible for me to not be cheered up even a little bit whenever I would be at one of his streams.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, this is the official, you know, the official podcast segment of. Section of my site, RT Gomer Productions, saying farewell, Justin. You know, it was fun, and we hope that, you know, if there is an afterlife, if there is somewhere you go after you die, we hope you're there, and, you know, we hope you're having fun and petting all of the kitties
and hanging out with Mr. Rogers, having a beer.
Yes, have all of the beers with Mr. Rogers. Yes.
Don't have all of the beers because I want a beer. So
yes,
save us one.
Oh! If they're in a they're in that kind
just
of a place,
pour one out for your homies that are left behind.
Yes. if there is a place like that where they can get all of the beer, I think there will be plenty for us when we get there.
Yeah.
I think so. So with that. Like I said, we're going to get out of here a little early, so we'll have some time to fit the video clip in before it goes too much over time. So if you want to find me on the social medias, you can find me at Gomer21XX on Twitter. You can also find me on patreon.com/Gomer21XX. That, you know, you brought up how Justin was trying to raise up funds for his Famicom and Rider. I'm doing something similar, except it's more with the site. Got a couple of people who've already pledged. I'll give them a shout out on Thespian Talk, as I promise, on the Patreon page. But if you want to, you know, just help out, you know, support the site and support for the productions. The productions are still free. I want to make that clear. But this will help improve different things. Like, you're probably hearing my mic and it's just not the best. I can do better.
Plus shit breaks.
Yes. So
yeah.
And it's a pain in the ass to try and get a job around here in this economy. But that's a rant for another time. But it's at patreon.com/Gomer21XX. I'll probably tweet it, you know, I'll probably have the link in the actual description. Either, you know, on my site on Nerdvice, which is where you can find me as well, nerdvice.com, and of course my site rtgomer.com. And these shows are also going up on YouTube as well, so which is really good. I've started to do that because the video will be that much better, you know, in the video format. Mm-hmm. So Holly, where can we find you?
You can find me all over the internet as Gookygox, GookyGox. So that's Twitter, Tumblr, Instagram, probably
Etsy.
Pinterest, Etsy. Yeah, that's my Etsy shop. Go there, buy some pretty things. If you don't see a pretty thing that you like, ask me to make you a pretty thing. That's...
Yes. Yes.
All the things.
Yes. And then my Facebook fan page, Holly Christine Brown.
Yes. And also as a bonus, if you're watching this or listening to this on my site, you know, you can also go up to the buyer stuff and Holly's store link is in there as well. So if you like get the hankering, which you forgot to bookmark it, I don't remember where it is, then just go to the site and it's in the shop links there. Misha, where can we find you?
Oh, goodness. I am busy, busy, busy. I, of course, am also on Space Monkey Mafia Studios. I do Snarkcast, Snark Sports, and Bacon Strippers. I am, of course, on this site under Misha Mayhem with my articles. I am Misha underscore Mayhem on Twitter, and also Snarkcast, Snark Sports, and Bacon Strippers have Twitter handles there. And I am Misha Mayhem 84 on Tumblr.
All right. So, again, thank you guys so much for listening. This things are going to be a little bit more peppy and probably more upbeat next time, because we've between then and now we've got some other things that we can bring up as well.
Oh, God, I
But
hope so.
yeah. But considering what happened, it's like, yeah, this stuff, frontline. There you go. So, thanks for listening. We will catch you guys next time. Until then, this is Gomer the Ranting Thespian with Holly Christine and Misha Mayhem signing off.
Bye.
Goodbye.
You know what? I want you all to look at me. I want you all to look at me. I want you to, because what I'm about to say is important, I think. I've been thinking about this a lot lately. And I want you all to know this. This goes out to everybody. You're not stupid. Okay? You're not stupid. Don't ever tell yourself that you are. You're important. What you have in your head may not mean a lot to a lot of people, but it's what makes you special. You are important. You mean something. And you're going to go out there and you're going to do some wonderful things. But first and foremost, you're not stupid. You're not an idiot. Don't ever tell yourself that you are. And if nobody else ever tells you this, I will tell you this. I care about you.